The Cold War between the US and the USSR gave way to the most impressive technological developments in human history. No stone was left unturned, from nuclear missiles, submarines, and warships, to aircraft and spacecraft. Nevertheless, few were as fascinating and intriguing as the Soviet ekranoplans, or screen gliders, vehicles that move over the surface by gaining support from the reactions of the air against solid ground or water. Among them stood tall the Soviet Bartini Beriev VVA-14, or vertical takeoff amphibious aircraft, envisioned to make the most out of the ground effect principle and VTOL capabilities. Nicknamed the Slavic Dragon due to its futuristic shape and imposing size, the aircraft's objective was to hunt and destroy American submarines carrying nuclear warheads close to the coastline of the Soviet Union. There was no American counterpart to this colossus, providing the Soviets with a unique asset in the arsenal their enemy could not match. The birth of a dream. To fully understand and appreciate the nature of this unique Soviet Union amphibious vehicle, it is necessary to delve into the mind of its mysterious creator, Roberto Ludvigovich Bartini, or Roberto Oros de Bartini. The future inventor was born in May 1897 in Fiume, part of the Kingdom of Hungary of the Austro-Hungarian Empire at the time. Young Bartini was born into nobility. His father, Lodovico Oros de Bartini, was a baron of the empire and the lieutenant governor of Fiume. Although born out of wedlock, Roberto was legitimized by his father, but his custody was given to poor relatives that only provided the child with the most basic education. When World War I broke out, Bartini was drafted into the Austro-Hungarian military in 1915 and became an officer. In 1916, Officer Bartini was deployed to the Eastern Front and captured by Russian forces. Bartini and other Empire soldiers remained prisoners of war until their release in 1920, when Russia retired from the war to fight the Red Revolution. The young officer relocated to Italy and became a member of the Italian Communist Party. Bartini also began to dedicate time to his greatest passion, aviation. Since age 15, Bartini had dreamt of one day reaching the skies, after attending an air show where he was left deeply impressed by the fluid maneuvers of a Russian pilot aboard a Beriev 11, one of the first mass-produced aircraft. Bartini attended Milan's Polytechnic Institute to finish his engineering career and complement his flight training near Rome to become a full-fledged aerospace engineer. The young officer's familiarity with communist literature and knowledge of multiple languages earned him the nickname Red Baron from his communist colleagues due to his noble origins and passion for communism and aviation. Serving the Motherland. Bartini's established life in Italy as a licensed pilot came crashing down when Benito Mussolini rose to power in 1922. All communists began to be persecuted by the fascist regime, and Bartini was no exception. The International Communist Party highly valued Bartini's aerospace skills and sent him to the Soviet Union to avoid capture. He was granted Soviet citizenship and changed his name to Robert Ludvigovich Bartini. The engineer put his aviation knowledge to the service of the motherland, working for the Kadinka Research and Development Airport of the Soviet Air Force in Moscow. Shortly after, Bartini climbed through the ranks and was made the Amphibious Experimental Aircraft Design Team chief, designing seaplanes near Sevastopol. 2 years later, he left the Air Force and was hired by the Red Army to work on the Stahl series aircraft. In 1930, the designer coordinated the preparations for the flight of TB-1 Strana Sovyetov, or Land of the Soviets, to the United States, earning him several prizes and a solid place among the most renowned aerospace engineers. Under Bartini's direction, the Stahl 6 high-speed aircraft achieved a world speed record in 1932, reaching a top speed of 420 kilometers per hour. This success allowed him to continue developing the Stahl 7 dual-purpose aircraft, which consumed his time from 1934 to 1937. Nevertheless, Bartini did not get to see the end of the project. He was arrested in 1938 under Stalin's orders for allegedly being Mussolini's spy and planning acts of sabotage. The designer was sentenced to a 10-year imprisonment in Tupolev Sharashka, a prison-type secret aircraft design bureau where Bartini remained during the entirety of World War II, despite several relocations, as the Germans attempted to take over the Soviet Union. Gliding over the future. Bartini was released in 1946 and moved to Omsk, where he focused his attention on variable sweep aircraft designs, and later to the TU-117, the world's first wide-body passenger and cargo transport aircraft. In the early 1950s, Bartini's attention shifted toward flying boats and aircraft capable of landing on water. He had previously built the DAR prototype, a twin-engine amphibious plane envisioned for reconnaissance operations in the Arctic. This led him to once again focus on amphibious aircraft designs that were heavily focused on the principle of ground effect. The so-called ekranoplans were vehicles that could fly very close to water or land surfaces, maintaining a dual nature. Ekranoplans, or ground effect vehicles, could move over the surface by gaining support from air reactions against the water or the Earth's surface. The aerodynamic interaction between the moving wing and the surface could even allow this type of vehicle to move over frozen lakes like a hovercraft. Also called wing and ground effect, or WIG, ground effect vehicles require forward velocity to produce lift, reducing the wing's lift-dependent drag. Ekranoplans had wings that were much shorter than those of standard aircraft, as the designs relied more on airfoil to generate more lift than drag. Nonetheless, ekranoplans still required a high, aft-placed horizontal tail for optimal stability. Besides using a straight wing configuration, ekranoplans could employ a reverse delta wing and tandem wing designs, each with unique benefits to the airframe. Bartini was ambitious. He sought not just to develop an ekranoplan, but an aircraft capable of VTOL, or vertical takeoff and landing capabilities. If a ground effect vehicle was seen with perplexity, an aircraft with helicopter-like capabilities was a thing of the future. It was the Cold War, after all. Bartini's ideas, like many of his time, were ready to defy the technology of the time and set new boundaries for the arms race between the United States and the Soviet Union. Cold War threats. The early 1960s led to new military and political tensions between the U.S. and the USSR. The failed Bay of Pigs invasion conducted by the CIA and the Cuban Missile Crisis put the world on the brink of global war. The two superpowers had hundreds of ICBMs, or intercontinental ballistic missiles, at their disposal, ready to annihilate one another. Their arsenals also had plenty of weapons of mass destruction to bring total havoc. From conventional to nuclear, biological, and chemical weapons delivery, this new type of missile based on the German V-2 rocket was devastating, and they became even more powerful with their submarine variant. In 1961, the U.S. Navy came up with the Polar Missile, a groundbreaking, solid-fueled, nuclear-armed submarine-launched ballistic missile, or SLBM, that would serve until 1980. Besides silos in undisclosed locations, nuclear warheads could now be launched by nuclear-powered submarines lurking in the shadows of the ocean. This brought new dangers to the borders of the vast Soviet Union. Paranoia went rampant among the top brass of the Red Army. Those U.S. Navy submarines could approach the borders of the USSR unnoticed, launch their nuclear missiles without anyone noticing, and target Moscow or any other important city. With more than 70,000 kilometers of coastline, it was impossible for the Red Army, Air Force, and Navy to simultaneously protect the coast of the Soviet Union, and more importantly, destroy the American submarines carrying nuclear ordnance. The USSR desperately required new anti-submarine warfare solutions to face this new threat, and turned to the one and only Bartini to find a solution. Naturally, he suggested his unique vertical takeoff and landing amphibious aircraft based on the ground effect principle. The visionary believed it would make an excellent anti-submarine aircraft system. With no more options left on the table, the Soviet government agreed. The next generation. The Italian-born designer got to work without hesitation and dusted off the blueprints of the first U.S. submarine killer, the MVA-62. Bartini presented the futuristic VTOL project in 1962, stating it would fly like an ekranoplan, making it more suitable than conventional warships due to its amphibious nature. Only one MVA-62 was produced and tested, paving the way for the Red Baron's next amphibious aircraft, the VVA-14. This plane's first objective would be to detect enemy submarines across the vast coastlines of the Soviet Union. It would also serve as a search and rescue aircraft for stranded sailors. Bartini partnered with the Beriev Design Bureau to develop the first prototype of the VVA-14, a Russian acronym for Vertical Takeoff Amphibious Aircraft. The aircraft would be developed in three phases. The first, VVA-14M1, would be an aerodynamics and technology testbed, comprising rigid pontoons on the ends of the wing sections instead of the inflatable pontoons meant for use at sea. The VVA-14M2 prototype would be focused on the fly-by-wire controls and the testing of the two starting engines placed under the wing to analyze if they could provide the necessary initial lift and the vertical takeoff and landing capability. The third and final prototype, BVA-14M3, would be used to test the vehicle for its anti-submarine role. It would be armed with the Bore-1 Magnetic Anomaly Detector, or MAD, the Borevesnik Computerized Anti-Submarine Warfare, or ASW, system, and other equipment. Armament-wise, the aircraft could carry 2 torpedoes and 16 bombs or mines. Once the project layout was confirmed, Bartini and his team got to work and developed the BE-1 prototype wing that would be used for his aircraft. A dream vanishes. Bartini's futuristic aircraft had a length of 26 meters, a wingspan of 30 meters, and a height of almost 7 meters. It had a gross weight of 52,000 kilograms. The crew of the VVA-14 consisted of 3 men. The power plant comprised 12 turbofan lift engines, providing a maximum speed of over 760 kilometers per hour, and a service ceiling of almost 10,000 meters. The VVA-14 had a range of 2,450 kilometers and a cruise speed of 640 kilometers per hour. VVA-14M1 was delivered in early 1972 and flew for the first time on September 4th. The engineers and military officers on the scene gave it the nickname Zmei Gorynych, or Slavic Dragon, due to its impressive dimensions. Some shortcomings were detected during flight, and Bartini set out to solve them. He made several changes to the design and installed the inflatable pontoons for its amphibious performance. While Bartini was awaiting the arrival of the vertical takeoff engines to test the VTOL capabilities of the VVA-14M, they dragged on, and death surprised the creator at 77 years of age. He was buried with honors at Vedenskoye Cemetery, Moscow. The ambitious aircraft project slowly lost momentum and was eventually canceled without the innovations of its creator. During testing, the VVA-14 flew 107 times and logged more than 103 hours of flight time. Only one of the two prototypes survived. VVA-14 was transferred to the Soviet Central Air Force Museum in 1987, where it remains today in a lackluster state. According to Rustek, who commemorated Bartini's anniversary in May 2023, the Italian Baron of Soviet Aviation requested in his last will to, quote, place all his documents, papers, and photographs in a sealed lead box and open it at his 300th anniversary in 2197, hoping, apparently, that at least future generations will appreciate his work. Bartini was a Renaissance man, full of ideas, too advanced for his time. Perhaps when his final papers are opened in the future, people will be surprised by more unconventional aircraft designs. Thank you for watching our video. Please like and subscribe to our Dark Skies channel to watch more footage about incredible aircraft developed during the Cold War. Don't forget to hit the bell icon to be notified of our newest videos.